Mr. Astudillo, in your case, how does your ticket see this possible Sara Duterte Bongbong Marcos tandem, or even the other possibility? We're also hearing from informed people from those camps of the possibility that they could run separately, both for president. I mean, how would those options affect your candidate's chances?
Well, it was also here on ANC Christian that I was asked that question for the first time. Tonight would be the second time I was asked that question. And to be fair to both my candidates, they were one of the first actually to announce to, well, there was a soft announcement, so to speak, last July. You know? And then they formally announced it in September. So suffice it to say that at the time that they made a soft announcement and when they finally made a formal announcement, at least to my two candidates, it did not matter who will be running. So that speaks to the strength of the tandem as well as to our campaign team. Now, it's not enough that you are that you have a strong campaign. You also have to be smart. So that also means calibrating and adjusting your campaign as the campaign unfolds. So as we have seen, it is there's another chapter that's being added to this campaign season again, or well, it's not really officially campaign season yet, but somehow it's already campaign season on the ground. Mm-hmm. So you have this new chapter unfolding before us, and which will come to light really this Monday, no? November 15th, when the deadline for substitution rolls around. Now, okay. The thing about this latest development is whatever the father was when he ran or when he said that he will not run, and the way the daughter is behaving right now, whether it's Duterte the first or Duterte the second or the daughter, you really can't take anything at face value with this family, no? Because they will say that they won't run, but apparently they will. So what remains to be determined is what position, you know? And I'm sure between Kong Walden and myself, we will always have information from this or that person or from this or that camp that she may run for this or that position. But the point of the matter is we won't really know until Monday. Yeah, and, definitely. You know, I wouldn't sweat too much about it. I won't overanalyze, you know, what possible moves she will make and what possible move this other candidate will make. Because at the end of the day, Christian, no, and I'm sure Kong Walden will agree with this, you play to your strengths. You know, it doesn't matter what the other camps should do. You should be cognizant of what they will do. But, you know, you should not be unsettled by it at the end of the day, Christian.
Okay, before I ask about your respective campaign platforms and how you gentlemen intend to differentiate your own campaigns and identities from the rest of the pool, I'd also like to ask about the chances first, muna, no? I think in the case of Senate President Tito Soto was running for vice president, based on recent surveys, is a top-notcher, no? But of course, that's just a snapshot of a particular public sentiment at a particular time. So basically, how confident are you that even if, let's say, Sara Duterte joins a vice presidential race, or it's Bongbong Marcos, your candidate could beat either of them?
Okay, that's a good question, Christian. No? All the surveys that have come out so far did include Sara Duterte in them. So that is to say that beginning from a low single-digit first quarter of this year, I think it is only Ping Lacson, who is running for president, who can say that he has been consistently gaining on each survey. And those surveys did include Sara Duterte. And in fact, if she was not included in another survey, it would show that Ping Lacson would rate higher. Now, for us, given this latest development, the baseline should be the next survey that will feature all the complete candidates. That, to me, will be the more reliable baseline. However, the value of the earlier surveys will tell us that there is a positive trajectory of our candidate for president in Ping Lacson. And it is shown by not just one survey, but another one or two surveys outside of the very recent one that came out last September, no, where it showed that a particular candidate was leading. So as to your question, whether or not I believe that Ping Lacson has a chance to win, absolutely. Absolutely. No? I believe so because, like I said, there has been a positive trend in the last three surveys that we've been tracking. And okay, it's not just one survey. And these are a couple of surveys. And second point, and this is not very evident, no, to most people, the strength of the campaign team. And not only, like I said, not only do we have a strong tandem in Ping Lacson and Tito Soto, their entry into the Derby also brings with it, you know, the strength of Partido Reforma, which has been revitalized. There's also the strength of the NPC. I'm not saying it's the entire NPC that will be supporting the tandem, but maybe a significant portion of it. There's also the NUP, okay? And that also does not include all the unnamed volunteers and supporters who have come on board since the tandem first announced their candidacy. So a lot of this, Christian, is, you know, these are the tangibles that will later on make the difference, no? But they are not very evident right now.
Okay. Professor Walden, in your case, you're running for vice president, and that was quite a surprise early on, no? When you suddenly threw your hat. Although others were expecting you to run for president at that time. Tito, in the case of Bongbong Marcos and Sara Duterte, do you actually see unity between two political clans or dynasties? Or you see two competing egos who basically cannot get their act together and could end up running separately?
Well, I think, you know, that this is a complementary dynastic push, no? Ang sabi nga namin, Christian, noong pang nagsimula kami ng Mika Liodi, several weeks ago, we're up against the axis of evil, no? The evil Marcoses and the evil Dutertes. And we will keep on hammering on that in the campaign, no? And I think that, of course, this will upset the crazy DDS and, you know, the crazy Marcos block. But that will make headway in the population, in the citizenry, as this electoral campaign goes along. No? So, Bastet, ang nakikita namin rito is ipapakita namin that this is an effort by two powerful dynasties to make fools of the people and to divide up the country among themselves. So, but I just wanted to say, you know, that they, you know, this kind of move is something that they're taking people for granted. No? They're thinking Filipinos are stupid, that they will allow themselves to be divided up by this tandem. No? But we're beyond that now. And it, as the campaign goes along, you know, the flaws of this strategy will really emerge. You know, I think that it is a deadly formula for them.
Okay. At this stage, siguro, pag-usapan natin, enough with the Marcos Duterte tandem. Let's talk about your own strengths as candidates, as tickets. For example, let's start with Mr. Ashley Acevedo. Why should voters go for Ping Lacson for president and Tito Soto for vice president? What basically differentiates your candidates from the rest in the pool?
Well, I'd like to take off from the point of Kong Walden earlier, no, about the seeming lack of experience in the national stage of the elder Duterte, and that and I agree with him, no, that played a very big role in the mess that we are in right now, no. experience apparently is not enough, Christian, because you have to talk about relevant experience. Okay, in the case of the Philippines, we did very badly under under presidents whose sole background in politics was as mayor or as in a local politics. No, and I would hazard to say that anytime, anywhere, regardless of the backlash. Now we have two potential mayors running for the highest office. And I will see the same situation playing out if they do make it, if either make it as president. Which brings me to my candidate, no? Ping Lacson, and why his experience in the national stage is relevant. And I'm not talking only about his long experience in the Senate, which is, of course, very important. No? Yung rigor niya in, yung sa pagbabalangkas ng budget, yung sa pag... ano, no? Basically, in passing legislation, will come into play when you deal with a recalcitrant Congress, for example. When you have to deal with the fact that the national budget, which is the lifeline of the government, will have to be an effective instrument of your governance. So you have to have a very good grasp of how that plays out in first in the lower house and then eventually in the Senate. Budget. And third, Ping Lacson also has very relevant and very recent experience in the executive. I'm talking about his stint as the presidential advisor for reconstruction and rehabilitation. And previous to that, the Philippine National Police enjoyed its highest approval rating when he was chief of the PNP. Imagine being able to manage and turn around a problematic organization as the PNP. Imagine what you can do as president, no? So when he talks about fixing the problems of the country, and these are basically fixing the problems that are rooted in government, then I have very high confidence that a Lacson presidency will be able to deliver on that promise, Christian.
Okay. Now let's talk about the chances of Professor Walden Bello. For those who are familiar with your background, your resume is quite thick and can measure up with any other candidates, even for president. And that is an objective assessment because of your background. But do you find it hard to basically sell, quote-unquote, yourself to voters to make them at least look at your record? And my next question for you also is, how do you distinguish yourself as a candidate from the rest?
Okay. Unang-una, Christian, kami ni Caliode, our presidential candidate, are not politicians, no? Clearly, that is something that we feel is very important, especially in a country right now that is tired of politics as usual, no? Every day nakikita nila yung, you know, political squabbling, Duterte on TV, Harry Roque's face, telling lies. You know, they're sick of politicians. And kami ni Calio, they were not politicians. Pangalawa, yung record namin, no? I think that Calio's work as a National Federation personality of labor, no? And his constant fighting for the interests of the poor and the marginalized, I think there is no dispute that this is a person who has never compromised in his in terms of his principles. No? So, mabangong mabango si Caliode. As for me, hindi ko naman sa pinagmamayabang, but Ashley knows that, and he mentioned this earlier, the only recorded resignation on a matter of principle, you know, that occurred in the whole history of the Philippine Congress. No, nobody resigns from Congress, but I did because I had very deep disagreements on principle with President Aquino. The other thing is our record on opposition to the Marcos regime. I was jailed in the United States for actions that we did. So my record kami of fighting for people and suffering for it. But beyond the record, is we are the only tandem that has now presented a complete platform, no? Whether it's on climate change, whether it's on agriculture, on labor, on women, LGBT, sinabi namin yung latest announcement namin is that more than 50% of our cabinet will be made up of women and LGBTQ. No? Yes. So this is and then, but then to contrast that, no, with what does Sara Duterte have to offer except running in the shadow of her father? No, mm-hmm. What does Marcos have to offer except a record of plunder? They don't even have programs to address these burning issues of the country at this point in time. No, all they're running on is for Sara, it's hey, vote for me because I'm Duterte's daughter. And for the Marcos, it's because of a false image cultivated through the internet that the Marcos years were golden years when there were in fact years of nightmare. At lalabas lahat yan sa kampanya. Kaya we're confident, no? It's an uphill struggle, no? Okay. But we're confident we will be able to show that this Duterte-Marcos tandem is not the way to go. It can only lead to disaster.
Okay. I'd like to ask Mr. Acedillo regarding this. Kanina sinabi ni former Congressman Walden Bello na if they get elected into office, they would fill more than 50% or half of your cabinet, no? With members of women and LGBT. Tama po ba?
Yes.
Professor Walden? Okay. In your case, isa sa mga concerns na pwedeng i-raise sa inyo, di ba? Because you yourself used to be from the PNA, former Air Force pilot si former Congressman Acedillo. Baka naman pag naupo si Ping Lacson tsaka Tito Soto, kapaka-militarize ang cabinet. The same issue that was raised during the time of FBR. And before you answer that, I'd also like to read a comment directed to your candidates. Sabi ng isa sa nanonood sa atin, Ping Lacson supported Duterte in one of the most draconian measures of his presidency, Anti-Terrorism Act. It only accentuates his own authoritarian bent, shown clearest when he was an enforcer for Marcos's martial law. Okay, binabalik yung days ni Ting Lacson at Metropon. Two questions for you there.
Christian, I'll deal with the second question first now with regard to Ting Lacson's so-called martial law record as well as his support of the anti-terror law. First, let me just say this out loud. No? The anti-terror law, to which I was one of the petitioners in the Supreme Court, no? Is the subject of 31 petitions against it, and it's now pending in the Supreme Court. Without getting into a discussion which would put us in a situation where it's sub judice matter, let me just say this about his support, no? Any administration can actually weaponize any administration can weaponize any piece of legislation or law. Okay, it doesn't have to be the anti-terror law. Now, Ping Lacson's support of the anti-terror law was premised on two things. No, first, because it was assigned to his committee, and second, he has always believed in a strong policy against terrorism, to which we needed to address. No, until today, because we belong to the top 10 most dangerous countries in the anti-terrorism index. So therefore, his support of that piece of legislation is not to gift anything to Duterte on a silver platter. Merely to give this government and any succeeding government a chance to fight and to put up a strong fight against terrorism. Because Christian, if you have, you must remember the law that was passed in 2007, HSA or the Human Security Act, was only able to obtain one conviction for a terror offense. And it wasn't even against a known terrorist, no? Okay. It was just a so-called terrorist act. So you could see that there was a need to not only to amend, but to overhaul the anti-terror infrastructure that was put in place in 2007.
Actually, but I think the problem is not exactly as to whether there should be an anti-terrorism law. The question is with the provisions that could be damaging to the common people, not just activists, right?
Okay.
And tama ba? Do I take it to mean you're among the petitioners?
Yes.
Don't you find it awkward that you're defending the your candidate now, who is the main author and sponsor of the anti-terrorism?
No, it's not awkward, Christian. In fact, that speaks highly of him, because if he can tolerate someone with my views in his campaign, then I see it as a good sign that when he becomes president, he will be able to tolerate opposing views, if only to sharpen a government policy, Christian. No?
Okay. And, yung other question ko kanina pala, sorry, because we don't have much time anymore. Yeah. Are we seeing a militarized cabinet?
Okay.
In case you win.
And this would be the most surprising aspect of a Lacson presidency, Christian. You will not see a proliferation of former military men in his cabinet. You know why? In the same manner that he expects of himself and his running mate, Tito Soto, three premier qualities, no? And these are integrity, competence, and courage. And not just physical courage, but more importantly, moral courage. He expects the same of his appointees in government. So it is not that they have previous military backgrounds or they have ties going back to their PMA days. That will not be the premium for selection to a Lacson administration, Christian. It will be primarily integrity, competence, and more important, equally important, moral courage, Christian.
Okay. Finally, very brief na lang, because we have another segment, an equally important topic. I'd like to ask former Congressman Walden Bello, take this opportunity to speak with the public as to what is at stake in these 2022 elections, why people cannot afford to drop the ball or make the bad choices again?
Well, I think it is fairly clear now, you know, that the great danger to the country is a combined Marcos restoration and a continued authoritarianism of the continuity of authoritarianism of Duterte. No? And that is why we have chosen the very graphic slogan that we are up against the axis of evil, because we are up against a family, for instance, that would like to rape the country again. And at the same time, the strong possibility, you know, that there will be a continuation of things like the extrajudicial killings, which have characterized the Duterte administration. So we cannot take a risk in having this tandem, where whether they are president or vice president, or vice president or president, interchangeable, take over the country. And the second thing that I would just like to raise is that we offer a path to the future. You know, we do not want the country to go back to the nightmare years of Marcos. Neither do we want the country to just stay where it is right now, where we have, a really very disorganized and corrupt political system. Kaya nga, napakahalaga, Christian, yung program namin, it is okay, a socialist and a democratic program. At ipapakita ho namin yan during the campaign. Why it is the program that responds to the future, especially to the needs of the young right now that are so disillusioned with the system. Okay. So we're confident we will be able to make that message. Although, Christian, sinabi ko na nga, it is going to be an uphill struggle. But okay, we're confident that we'll get, you know, a critical mass of people behind us.
Okay. Mr. Walden Bello and Mr. Ashley Acedillo, thank you, gentlemen, for joining us tonight. Unfortunately, we don't have time anymore. But thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Christian.